Greetings. Don't worry. Be happy. This whole prophecy thing ain't no stopping it. God has the advantage of knowing what will happen. Actually, what has happened in our future. Remember, it's not his future. It's not future to him. God is already there. But I'm not going to dive off into predestination in this video. I just want to talk about prophetic inevitability. First, I want to remind you of Prophet David. How did David encourage himself when he faced difficult times? He recalled previous times when God demonstrated his faithfulness. 1 Samuel 17:34. But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck it and killed it." David recounted his victory over the lions and bears. "Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God." "Moreover," David said, "the Lord who delivered me." Think about that. "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear." David gives God the credit for his victories. "He will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. In David's mind, past performance was indication of future results. So much for legal hedging and small print in his covenant. David recalled examples that proved God's faithfulness. I want you to think on examples of God fulfilling prophecy, even as others thought they could stop it. So how exactly might this apply to current prophetic events, trends, coming attractions? This whole prophecy thing ain't no stopping it. When men have tried, their efforts actually fulfilled the prophecy. When Satan has tried, his efforts actually fulfilled the prophecy. Let's examine two examples. The first prophecy is the following. Ezekiel 44:1. "Then he brought me back the way of..." Ezekiel is having a vision. It began in the previous chapter. Context is always critical, but in this case, does not change the meaning of this section. But I encourage you to read it. If you are interested, let me know if you think it changes the meaning. "Then he brought me back the way of the gate of the outward sanctuary, which looketh toward the east." So this is the gate facing to the east, called the Eastern Gate, or Golden Gate. "And it was shut." This gate, the Eastern Gate, is now shut in this prophetic vision of the future. "Then said the Lord unto me, This gate shall be shut, it shall not be opened." In Ezekiel's day, the gate was probably always open. People walked in and out to access the temple. But "it shall not be opened" sounds like a permanent closure of some kind, for some reason, some purpose. "And no man shall enter in by it." This could mean only women will, in a Clinton-esque parsing, but I don't think so. Instead, "no one shall enter" resonates as a more accurate meaning. But is there a reason for this architectural edict? Because the Lord. Notice it's all in caps. That means the Hebrew word underneath this is the tetragrammaton, Jehovah. Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the God of Israel, has entered in by it. The reason is Jehovah God has entered in by it. God is spirit, so clearly he could just float over the wall. As a spirit, Jehovah God could enter and leave, and no one would ever see him. This is different. God physically passing through the gate. Therefore, it shall be shut. The reason it is shut, closed forever, is because Jehovah God has passed through it. Therefore, it shall be shut. Now, we Christians know Jesus is Jehovah God in the flesh. It is for the prince. Perhaps for the Prince of Peace. Isaiah 9:6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." It is for the prince. The prince, he shall sit in it and eat bread before the Lord, Jehovah. He shall enter by the way of the porch of that gate, and shall go out by the way of the same. The gate was open when Jesus was alive. Jesus would have entered and left via that gate toward the Mount of Olives. In doing so, Jehovah God would have entered in through the gate, fulfilling this first part. Because the Lord, the God of Israel, has entered in by it, therefore it shall be shut. Notice it does not say when it would be shut. Centuries pass, and more centuries pass. The gate is still open during that time, people using it. Through the centuries, different Muslims read of the prophecy. The Jewish God will pass through the gate. Each Muslim with sufficient power responds by bricking the gate closed to stop the Jewish God, because they think that a brick wall will stop the God of creation. Subsequent times of Christian control, such as the Crusaders, allows Christians to unbrick the gate. Honestly, that seems contrary to the prophecy, but they probably wanted access to Old Jerusalem from the east, and were simply ignorant of the prophecy that is simplified to once closed, always closed. The centuries continued to pass, and finally Caliph Suleiman came on the scene. He appears to have followed in the footsteps of previous Muslims. An Islamic scholar in service to Caliph Suleiman reads Ezekiel. The Islamic scholar is terrified by the prophecy, the God of Israel will enter the temple by the east gate. The Islamic scholar informs Caliph Suleiman, potentially of both the prophecy and the history of Muslims bricking up the gate, and the conniving, scheming Christian crusaders who reopen the gate, so perhaps their God can enter Jerusalem. Caliph Suleiman knows what he must do. He becomes the last in a succession of Muslims to stop the God of the Jews and Christians from entering the temple through the east gate. So Caliph Suleiman in 1541 became the last Muslim to brick the gate closed, and it remains closed to this day. Clearly, in a mind retarded by Islam, a brick wall can stop the God who created the universe. Poor Muslims, including Suleiman, did not know that Jehovah God had already entered in by the gate. Little did they know that each, including poor ignorant Caliph Suleiman, fulfilled the rest of the prophecy. Paul Harvey, good day. So understand this. Several Muslims, including the powerful Caliph Suleiman, tried their best to interfere with Jehovah God fulfilling his message by Prophet Ezekiel, with poor ignorant Caliph Suleiman being the last to fulfill the prophecy. The opposite of each Muslim's intentions. So that is our first example of humans seeking to divert, thwart, and interfere with prophecy, actually fulfilling the very prophecy they meant to thwart. I think I'll continue the next example in part two of this video series. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.